Namaskar, Adab and welcome. I'm Aditya and you're watching The Indian Atheist. This episode features the Emmy-nominated actress Mayim Bialik, best known for the adorable portrayal of the neurobiologist Dr. Amy Farrah Fowler in the hit CBC sitcom The Big Bang Theory. Mayim also happens to be a neuroscientist in real life in the sense that she has a PhD in that field from UCLA, no less. Somehow, one of her videos on science and religion made it to my YouTube recommendations, and I have to say I was hooked because it is just a riot of contradictions. I mean, it's one thing for someone with little background in science to defend faith, but it's entirely another thing for a person with a PhD in science to do the same, which is unfortunately not as uncommon as one might think. Although scientists are significantly less likely to be religious than most other people, irreligious scientists are still a minority among scientists the world over. Mayim's views are thus representative of a disturbingly large number of scientists. This video is therefore not about Mayim per se. It only features arguments made by Dr. Mayim Bialik, the scientist, in one particular video, and I'm just putting forward a counterview. It doesn't matter, therefore, that I actually like Mayim quite a lot as an actor. And I love Dr. Amy Farrah Fowler. I think I might also like Mayim as a person if I was a friend. I think she's a reasonable and a smart person in most spheres of her life that do not directly concern her religious faith. She seems like a kind and a warm person and a fun person to be with, you know. I have little against her as a person. It's just that I don't understand how scientists can entertain religious faith while they practice and live and breathe the scientific method, because faith is the very antithesis of science. This is not to say that scientists are immune to all types of faith, but religious faith is just too conspicuous of an aberration to escape unnoticed and unscathed the probing of reason. Having said that, there are many religious scientists who are tremendously successful in their fields. It's not ideal, I don't understand it, but I don't particularly mind it either. And really, there's no reason to, as long as they keep their religion to themselves in the workplace and tacitly understand that God and religion have nothing to do with science. But it's a serious breach of professional ethics to press your position as a scientist into the ambassadorship of religious faith and other pseudoscience in public. The central thesis of Mayim's video that we are discussing today is that religion is super compatible with science. As we shall see, while arguing for the compatibility of religion with science, Mayim ends up saying and defending things that are way outside what's even pondered by a skeptical mind. And that is why it is fantastic skepticism. Let's jump into the video.
As many of you know, I'm a scientist. I'm also a person who's part of an organized system of religion. In particular, I'm Jewish, and I believe in the tenets of Judaism, and I actually get a lot out of religious observance.
Let's see. I get a lot out of religious observance is a fairly subjective statement, and therefore it cannot, in principle, be falsified. It is for this very reason that such statements cannot be considered as valid arguments for or against any position. One can still say things like that in an argument. I say things like that all the time, but I understand that they carry no real value. I'm sure Mayim understands that too. She claims that she gets a lot out of religious observance. That's okay, that's what she feels. There's no way for me to prove that she doesn't feel what she's feeling, and that's why it's not admissible as far as her central thesis is concerned. However, I get a lot out of religious observance can also be considered as a statement that makes an objectively verifiable claim, as in you get X, Y, and Z out of religious observance, where X, Y, and Z are items that can be attributed primarily, if not solely, to one's religious observance. It then becomes theoretically possible to disprove the claim without having to appeal to personal feelings and emotions. Give me falsifiability, then we're in the game. Let's assume that Mayim is willing to admit an objective evaluation of her statement. Remember, the claim is that she gets a lot out of religious observance. We have a different theory. We have a counterclaim, which is the following. what she thinks she gets out of religious observance, she actually gets from a variety of other quite obvious sources. For starters, let's just consider three such sources. A, she's rich. B, she's white. And C, she's a US citizen. Her wealth, the color of her skin, and her nationality, or more generally, her geopolitical circumstances, are actually what she gets a lot out of, not her religious observance. Now, we must prove our counterclaim. Here's the proof. If she went bankrupt because of a terrible investment decision, let's say, she'd be in significant physical, mental, and social distress, despite her religious observance. If she was born a person of color, all things being equal, she'd find it a lot harder to get the opportunities that she did, which played a big role in her success. The relative scarcity of these opportunities would deeply affect the overall quality of her life, despite her religious observance. If she was raised in a Mumbai slum instead of US of A, she'd be much worse off across the board in every standard of life indicator, despite her religious observance. So money, race, and circumstance, each of these three things is on its own able to overshadow her religious observance as the primary source of her happiness. Together, they complement each other in various ways, which enhances the independent effect they have on a person's well-being. That is, when the three work together, the role of religious observance is diminished even further than it would have if they were operating independently. Many other factors can be thought of, and the argument repeated until one comes to the inevitable conclusion that religious observance has a wholly negligible effect on one's actual well-being as well as one's perceived sense of well-being.
You might be wondering, how can you be a scientist and also be a religious person?
Yes, I'm wondering that. Please enlighten us.
Scientists are only supposed to believe in observable, quantifiable things that they can physically have proof of.
Yes, but human beings, and not just scientists, are supposed to believe in observable, quantifiable things that they can have some measure of proof of. Of course, people are free to believe whatever they want, but there's hardly any reason to encourage beliefs that lack a rational justification. Because, I don't know, people end up killing each other over things they believe in and yet do not have any proof of. God is just one of those things. You may believe, for example, that your partner is having an affair without any proof, or that your maid stole your necklace, or that the increase in the population of a certain religious group is actually a part of an orchestrated strategy to outpopulate and overthrow the current majority. Beliefs that are held without a proper justification tend to harm the well-being of the people or the entities that feature in the unjustified belief, like climate change. So, scientist or not, it is in general a good idea to believe in something only when you have good reasons to believe in it. Insisting on some semblance of proof or rational justification for all our beliefs, and not just religious beliefs, can go a long way in making this world a much safer place. Just putting it out there.
Isn't being religious fundamentally in opposition to everything that being a scientist is about?
Yes, absolutely. But I hope the audience can detect the dismissive or rhetorical tone of the question, as if Mayim has a hitherto unrevealed insight for why being religious may not, in fact, be in opposition to being a scientist. Does she have a case? We'll find out soon enough.
These are good questions. I'm a thoughtful person, I'm a skeptical person, and I am not a person who believes blindly in anything.
These are good questions, we know, but you haven't answered them. Also, those are your questions. We haven't even started asking questions yet. Second of all, if you're a thoughtful person, you shouldn't need to say that. You should let other people say that about you. But fine, I guess it's a cultural difference. Even more egregious is the statement, I'm a skeptical person. Your arguments should do the job of saying that for you. No skeptic will ever say that in the preface of her argument, or in general, ever, except perhaps in a way that she knows will not bear any consequence to the preceding or succeeding arguments. Mayim, on the other hand, sounds like she's asking for a concession in her arguments, which she hasn't even made yet, on the grounds that she's a skeptical person. A skeptical person would know that such a concession is simply not possible. Being skeptical doesn't get you a free pass or anything like that. The rules of argument apply to a skeptical person, same as a person of faith. Finally, she claims to be a person who does not blindly believe in anything. But only three sentences ago, she said, "I am Jewish and I believe in the tenets of Judaism." Let's see. This is what Google throws up at me when I type in tenets of Judaism. The most important teaching and tenet of Judaism is that there is one God, incorporeal and eternal, who wants all people to do what is just and merciful. All people are created in the image of God and deserve to be treated with dignity and respect. This is from the official website of an embassy of the government of Israel. There are many other tenets that are far more scandalous, but let's just stick to this one without loss of generality. Tell me, how can anyone possibly believe that without being blind as a bat? Are you seriously telling me that you have a rational justification for believing, for instance, that there is one God? Why not two? Why not 27? Why not zero? Have you a justification for the belief that God is incorporeal or eternal? If you believe in something without justification, you believe in it blindly. You're taking the so-called leap of faith. Take the leap. It's your prerogative. But you don't get to maintain that it's not blind belief. Faith is blind. That's why it's called faith, because it doesn't require a justification. Also, please note that here I mean justification for believing in any given tenet as a Jew. Let's take, for example, the proposition that all people deserve to be treated with dignity and respect. Let's call this proposition A in what follows. Now, you may have ample justification outside of your religion for believing in proposition A. It's the belief in proposition A as a Jewish person that requires the extra layer of justification. Not only do you now have to justify your belief in proposition A, but you also have to justify why you need to be Jewish or some other religion to subscribe to the belief that proposition A is true. This is eminently falsifiable, thank you. Let me tell you how. If you can find just one person in the whole wide world who believes in proposition A, justifiably or blindly, I don't care, and if this person is not Jewish, you don't have a rational justification for believing in the Jewish tenet that proposition A is true. And additionally, the tenet stands falsified, that is, negated and not just rejected, because there is, of course, not one, not 10, not a million, but billions of such people. Ergo, the tenet stands falsified. If even one tenet is falsified, why should the rest be taken as true, let alone divine? Now, you could always counter that by saying that the tenet doesn't require that only a Jewish person can believe in proposition A, right? Go ahead, say that. I dare you. You know what this is, right? It's called a checkmate. Right, now that the tenet is falsified, you have to be blind, that is, metaphorically blind, to believe in the tenet as a Jew. And because it was so easy to prove this, you have to be blind as a bat to believe in the tenet as a Jew. But Mayim said she doesn't blindly believe in anything. This then is what religion does. It robs people of their ability or willingness to reason. And what's worse, sometimes it makes them lie through their teeth. And if it can do this to an American neuroscientist, imagine, just imagine what it could do to people who are not, well, American neuroscientists. Our one-sided debate with Mayim will continue in the next part. She hasn't even started arguing her position yet, and I'm already at full throttle. It may seem a little hostile, but I hope you'll see in the next part why all this groundwork was necessary. Now, in hindsight of the discussion so far, I'll let you listen to Mayim's introduction once again. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. Dhanyavaad. Shukriya.
As many of you know, I'm a scientist. I'm also a person who's part of an organized system of religion. In particular, I'm Jewish, and I believe in the tenets of Judaism, and I actually get a lot out of religious observance. You might be wondering, how can you be a scientist and also be a religious person? Scientists are only supposed to believe in observable, quantifiable things that they can physically have proof of. Isn't being religious fundamentally in opposition to everything that being a scientist is about? These are good questions. I'm a thoughtful person, I am a skeptical person, and I am not a person who believes blindly in anything.